Straining. I've been struggling. Straining. Let me tell you about a few things that happened to me in life. Since I decided to make Jesus my choice. Listen, y'all. I've been lying on. I've been talked about. I've been lying on. I've been talked about. I've been lonely. Anybody ever been lonely? I've been lonely. Anybody ever been lonely? But that's all right. Cause I made up my mind. I'm gonna hold on. I'm gonna hold on. Sometimes in life, broken hearted, y'all. Sometimes in life, tears all in my eyes. Sometimes in life, been disappointed. Sometimes in life, burdens been heavy, y'all. Sometimes in life, things ain't going the way you wanna go. Somebody out there been struggling. Somebody out there been struggling just like me. Won't God make a way for you? Won't God make a way for you? Sometimes I've been struggling, y'all. Somebody been struggling today, y'all. Somebody out there been struggling. But that's all right, y'all. Won't God make a way for you? Won't God make a way for you? I've been struggling, y'all. Straining, straining, straining. I've been struggling,
struggling.
I've been straining,
straining.
Cut it down, fellas. I've been struggling, straining. I've been struggling, straining. Let me see. I've been struggling, straining. But I'm on my way home. Yeah. Y'all been struggling?
Praise.
Yeah, sometimes life get hard. It cuts like a knife sometimes. You never know when that curve is going to come up in your life.
Yes.
You be going long straight and then boom. Here come that curve.
Yes. Come on now.
And if you don't navigate it just right, you know what's going to happen. You're going to run right off the road.
Yes.
But you got to have heaven in your view. Okay.
In your view.
Come on, maestro. Listen, when you trust in the Lord, yeah, with all of your heart, and I know the word of God will never depart. He said he'd go to prepare a place for you and I, and we'll see him in all his glory when we die. Do you have it?
Heaven
in your
heart. Heaven in your heart.
Do you have heaven?
Heaven. Heaven in your view.
Do you have heaven?
Heaven. Heaven in your view.
Well,
heaven in your view.
Well, when you're done all for the Lord, that you came down here and your life is coming to a close. Don't you wanna go where the streets are paved with gold? And trouble, trial, there won't be no more. Do you have
heaven
in your
heaven in your view? Heaven, heaven in your view.
Do you have heaven?
Heaven. Heaven in your view.
Well,
heaven in your view.
Oh, keep on looking up from which come up your hill. God's got a rainfall blessing for you. We got to do His will. Oh, do you have
heaven? Heaven in your view.
Do you have it?
Heaven. Heaven in your view.
Do you have heaven?
Heaven. Heaven in your view.
Break it down for me, say.
Heaven in your view.
Keep on, keep on looking up from where cometh your help. God's got a rainfall blessing for you. We got to do His will. Oh, do you have
it? Heaven, heaven in your view.
Do you have it?
Heaven, heaven in your view.
Do you have heaven?
Heaven, heaven in your view.
With somebody in the near vicinity of your pew, amen, on the side of you, on behind you, in front of you, amen, give them some dap, give them a chicken wing, an elbow, amen, take a few minutes and fellowship. Heaven, heaven in your view. Y'all better leave that alone. Amen. All right. Let's come on back to our seats. And the church said amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now somebody ain't listening to nothing I'm saying. Amen. Thank God for fellowship. All right.
David, really?
Amen.
Okay, David, we got it.
Amen. We're trying to get order to church. I'm gonna start sprinkling y'all in a minute. Y'all don't start getting there. Amen. We thank God again for the spirit of fellowship in this place. Come on, let's give God a hand praise today. He is worthy to be praised. Amen. We are just grateful to be in the land of the dying on our way to the land of the living. It's no accident that we are here today. It's no accident that God has kept us. God is watching over us. Amen. I have stood to present. I don't have to introduce our preacher for this morning. Grateful for his ministry, grateful for his teaching ministry, and grateful for his commitment, not only to God, but his commitment to the Pilgrim Valley Church Amen. Family. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. One thing about Reverend Lavenski Smith, amen, and all the things he has going on, he still takes out time to study the Word of God. Amen. You know, I hear folks talking about all the stuff they got to do and all the places they got to be. And, you know, as busy as he is, you never hear him complaining. Amen. When it's time to preach, when it's time to teach, when it's time to pour out, he's always ready. I'm reminded of the Apostle Paul when he wrote to the church at Ephesus in Ephesians 4. He says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation therewith ye are called. What Paul was trying to remind them, and I'm reminded of Lavenski Smith when he stands, he was reminding them, he said, that your walk ought to match your talk. He was trying to remind the church. He said, listen, you ought to walk worthy that your life is balanced with the testimony of Jesus Christ. And so I'm always, when I hear him, I just thank God for him. Amen. He's one who's a man of few words, but he tells it just like it, old folks say, like it is. Amen. He doesn't sugarcoat it. He doesn't sit there and add to it and take away from it. He just tells us what thus said the Lord. And so after a hymn of preparation, if you'll be so kind, we're going to sing Amazing Grace. And then after that hymn of preparation, we're going to receive our preacher for this morning. Let us receive him by saying, Reverend Lavenski, preach the word. If you want him to preach now, you need to say amen. 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 Let us all stand and let's get ready to sing Amazing Grace.
Check that. She says sometimes people can't hear me because I speak too low, but want to make sure you can hear me, or I guess I can try this other mic.
Is that better?
Well, I'll stick with this one. There we go. Great. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Praise the Lord. What a privilege to be in His house this morning. Pastor Greene has laid out for the coming year an emphasis on Jubilee as a theme for Pilgrim Valley. And to begin with, a focus on release. A release ends an obligation. And I wanted to seek the Lord's heart and mind for a message that would be in line with the stated theme for this portion of the year. And as I prepared, I believe the Lord gave me something. The text passage will be Hebrews, the beginning text, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And those verses read as follows. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Please be seated. What a wonderful passage of scripture that just reminds us of some very significant truths, much of which we're not going to be able to touch on this morning. Our topic this morning is going to focus on a particular phrase used in the first verse. He says, let us lay aside every weight. A release ends an obligation. When you're carrying something, your obligation to it ends when you put it down. When you lay it aside. And there are times when there are just some things you've got to put down because they hold you back. They are weights. And when you're getting ready to run a race, we don't really know Paul's getting ready to talk about a race until after he says, you got to lay aside. And then he tells us, once you get this down, then you can run. But if you try to run with the weights on, you're going to be beset, which means you're going to be hindered. You're going to be slowed up. I remember when I ran track, we used to train sometimes with ankle weights. Of course, that's been debunked as an unhealthy way to train because of the stresses it puts on your knee ligaments. But we used to train sometimes with leg weights, and go upstairs with leg weights, and you had kind of a psychological effect when you took the weights off. All of a sudden, you just seemed just a little bit lighter, like I can go just a little faster now when you take off those besetting weights. You know, the principle of Jubilee sounds wonderful. You know, when Pastor Greene started talking about it, and you look at the wonderful things that happen around Jubilee, it enables a fresh start and the preservation of heritage lands through the generations of Israel. But what if you're the lender? Or you're the injured party that's owed damages. And now somebody can just forget it. They don't have to pay. We tend to think perhaps if we're the one that an obligation was owed to, we've been wronged. We may not share that liberation felt by the debtor. You know, the debtor feels relief. I don't know about you, but if you've ever paid off something, Oh, it's so good. I mean, you pay off a car and you get that title in the mail. They go, yeah, I did that. Yeah, that's done. Can put that down. And no payment next month or the foreseeable future. Wonderful feeling. But if you're still owed and the person responsible for paying ceases to do so, it's a different feeling. This is also true of non-monetary injuries that we suffer. You know, sometimes somebody owes you something and it's not money. It may not be the return of stuff. Sometimes people can hurt you emotionally. They can hurt you in non-monetary, non-fiscal ways. And those things hurt too. But you know what? If you hang on to those things, if you carry those things, they will be a weight on your race to the glorification of Christ. So I want to talk a little while this morning about releasing the weights of resentment and revenge. Releasing the weights of resentment and revenge. God has called us to peace. Peace between us and peace certainly with Him within us. Some harms done to us need to be released in forgiveness to fully know the peace God intends for us. Too often resentment and revenge rather than release are the dominant responses to wrongs that we've incurred. Instead of releasing, there is in our minds this brewing, this festering sense of entitlement to retribution. They ought to pay for what they've done to me. I'm owed for what has occurred. I have a right to my anger. Much of the violence that plagues our communities has its origin in the strength of the desire for vengeance. I came across an opening statement in an abstract that a couple of professors at Yale University put together in a publication called the Journal of Law, Medicine, and Ethics. It's about 4 years ago. And the paper that they wrote was entitled Behavioral Addiction Model of Revenge, Violence and Gun Abuse. And it began with this statement. Data from multiple sources point to the desire for revenge in response to grievances or perceived injustices as a root cause of violence, including firearm violence. Neuroscience and behavioral studies are beginning to reveal that the desire for revenge in response to grievances activates the same neural reward processing circuitry as that of substance addiction, suggesting that grievances trigger powerful cravings for revenge in anticipation of experiencing pleasure. In other words, there is a sense that you got to do this. I've got to get back. They've got to pay. And the sense is, if they do, I'll feel better. If they do, there'll be a relief. But guess what? That kind of relief is not a type of release that frees your soul from the weight that will beset you in a good run for the Lord. God's word recognized this tendency in humanity, and to prevent widespread and potentially unjust vigilantism, established cities of refuge throughout the land of Israel. And Israel, when the Israel entered the promised land, they divided up into tribes that were regions as well as related to family. The one tribe that didn't get any land were the Levites. They were the priestly tribe. And the reason was their inheritance was from the Lord and not from going to be part of the land. So they were spread out among all of the tribes. There were Levites that lived in all of the tribes. And they were given certain cities. And of the cities of the Levites, there were about a half dozen, maybe a couple more, that were designated as cities of refuge. Scripture understood this principle that if there was a fight, two brothers got into it. Got in, I mean, as Jerry Clower, you say, fist fight. And somebody got injured to the point of losing their lives. That's a homicide. Question remains, is it murder? Is it manslaughter? Well, the Old Testament actually made those distinctions, not using those words, but that distinction was made as a difference between an intentional killing and a killing that occurred not by intent or because of intent. Well, there was this idea that you had a avenger. You had a revenger of death. And if somebody, you kill my brother, you kill my cousin, you kill my, and we coming to get you. Well, they had cities of refuge that if there hadn't been a trial and they hadn't figured out what happened, if they hadn't figured out if there was an actual intentional homicide, the accused could flee to a city of refuge and be safe until the matter was adjudicated. And why was that? It was because it was understood this was in human nature. You got to account for it. So God knows what we're like. These powerful cravings for vengeance can be seen acted upon routinely in the news. As believers, we're called to a much higher standard than the impulses of the flesh. Jesus taught his disciples that it was crucial for our power with God as servants and followers of Christ to forgive those who have wronged us, lest our unforgiving spirit hinder our prayers. You know, folks like to find favorite verses, and they always like these verses that say, I'm going to get something. Oh, yeah, I'm going to get something. I can get what I want. And one of those favorite verses is from Mark 11:24, where the Lord says, ask what you want, and you shall have it. You know, and this was in the context of Christ entering the city of Jerusalem. He just cursed the fig tree, and the disciples like, whoa, man, he just told that thing to die. And they come back out, and it's dead. And Christ says, don't marvel at that. He says, you can speak to the mountain and tell it to move. You can ask for what you want, you can have it. But a lot of times they'll read that far and won't go on. Context is critical. The next verse, verse 25, right after that, the Lord says this. He says, and he's been praying, you can get what you want. And, meaning this is connected to your prayer life. And when you stand praying, forgive. If you have aught against any. Think about what's going on in your life and in your mind and in your heart now. Do you have aught against any? Is there something in your mind, some harm that you perceive has been done to you? Maybe it's real and you've actually been hurt. Sometimes our perception is distorted and we've been hurt less than we think we have, but sometimes our hurts are real. Sometimes we've truly been offended. Sometimes we've truly been harmed. And in those circumstances, there is a desire for the correction of that. Sometimes we say we want justice, but in fact, we might actually just want revenge. Christ said, and when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any. that your Father which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. In other words, if you don't forgive, it's going to hinder all your prayers, including your prayer for forgiveness. In fact, he put it this way in the very next verse to leave no doubt, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. Paul exhorts us to live on a higher plane than that of the world. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, he says, put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. Y'all, that is completely antithetical to the mindset of the world. Completely opposite to the world will tell you to be proud. The world will tell you don't stand for that. Don't let them dish you. Don't let them put you down. But your value is not tied up in what the world thinks of you. God values you. I get it. God values you much more than anything you could ever get from the estimation of people as they try to put some price or cost or value on your life. God wants so much more for you, and he has so much in store for you. He tells us that we ought to be humble and have the kind of humility that recognizes that, yes, there will be times when hard, harsh things happen to us. But even when it happens because somebody wanted to do it, it doesn't mean we cannot forgive them. Paul says, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. All right. Meaning, we're not called to just a human level of forgiveness. You know, the playground kind of forgiveness. Right. Where your teacher told you, you know, you got into a tussle with one of your buddies, and the teacher came out and broke it up and told you to forgive him, and you kind of dust yourself off and, oh, I forgive you. And they said, I forgive you back. Well, you know, God calls us to something higher than that. He says, forgive as Christ forgave you. You know how Christ forgave you? Christ forgave you when you were the one who wronged him and he hadn't done you any harm. It wasn't a mutual forgiveness kind of thing where we bury the hatchet and we're through with our conflict because we had something against each other. No, y'all, this was all one-sided. We went into his house and busted everything. And he was willing to forgive. We, through sin, humanity, collectively, have corrupted the creation of God. We, by sin, have caused death and destruction in our own lives, tearing down the valuable things of God's creation. Yet God commends his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. While we were opposed to him, that's how he loved us. That's how he forgave us. And he asks us to forgive the same way. Knowing that we should forgive, though, doesn't tell us how to do it. How do we let go of the hurt? The sense of violation. And I don't know about you, but it hurts when somebody rips you off. You ever been ripped off? I mean, either by deception or actual rip-off. I remember the first time I got just ripped off was in college. This was in the 70s. I'm dating myself now. I had my parents' older car, the old family car I drove to college, and I decked it out. I had a CB radio and an 8-track tape deck. Mounted on the transmission hump in the front of the car. I'm telling you, I styled down the road. Parked it next to the place I stayed. Came out one morning. It was gone. The car was there, but my CB and my 8-track, they were gone. And there's just this feeling that just comes over you like, oh, no. You just feel violated. You know, I've been hurt.
Paint the picture.
You know. But in retrospect, you realize that wasn't much. It wasn't that much. I've been hurt in certainly more painful ways. But we have that feeling. The word, though, doesn't leave us in the dark about how to forgive. I want to talk about three things, and I'll leave you alone, as to how we release the besetting weights of resentment and revenge. First, remember this. Remember, God is in charge. And he has a plan. God is in charge and he has a plan. Sometimes this sense of violations, there's nothing we can do about it. I've got to get back at them. I've got to hurt them back. Otherwise, there'll be no justice. It's not true. God had a plan for allowing it, and God has a plan for dealing with it. And that plan does not involve you or I violating God's law. In the book of Genesis, we have the wonderful story of the 12 sons of Jacob. Mm-hmm. You know, Jacob was the grandson of Abraham and the heir of the promise of God to Abraham to bless all the nations of the world. And Jacob has these 12 sons, and before the 12th was born, he's down, he's got Joseph, and Joseph special. He was a son of Jacob's wife, Rachel, and Jacob loved Joseph, and loved him so much he made him a special coat, distinguished him from among his brethren, and his brothers started looking at him sideways. Mm-hmm. They started, when Joe would come in the room, they cut their eyes. And Joe really stepped in it one day. He came back after having a vision from the Lord, and at the dinner table, Joe says, "Daddy, you won't believe what I saw." And he told them the dream about how the rest of them were going to bow. And the brothers were about to choke on the supper. And they left out, and it's like, this is it. This is it. So they're out working one day, and here comes Joseph skipping up. And they were already plotting, what are we going to do? And they determined, initially discussing, actually killing him. But one of the older brothers stepped up and said, no. We ain't going to break daddy's heart like that. We ain't going to kill this boy. And they ended up selling him. Sold him to some itinerant merchants driving by, and they took him and sold him to Egypt into slavery, and he became a servant of an Egyptian leader named Potiphar. And the man, poor Joseph, he's been ripped off from his family. His brothers have threatened his life. They have hurt him physically. They have now completely removed him from his home, from those he loved, from his father, and put him in slavery. But Joseph didn't dwell on that. Joseph rose. Joseph had skills. Joseph had talent from God that God blessed him with. And Joe got a job in Potiphar's house and ended up running everything Potiphar owned. Right. Potiphar didn't, he trusted Joe so much he didn't even know all he had, but Joe knew it. And he trusted Joseph. Until one day, Joseph again got hurt badly by Potiphar's wife. I mean, she came in and, oh, Joe, you're such a nice boy. Oh, man, we won't go into the details, but needless to say, he had to leave the room in a hurry, leave his coat behind. And when Potiphar found out what had happened, of course, there was a different version that he was told by his wife, and Joseph was falsely accused, falsely blamed, probably could have been executed. But Potiphar had mercy and just locked him up in prison, sent him to prison. And he was there for years. And hope came along when a couple of Pharaoh's servants got sent to prison. And they would listen to Joe and they'd learn about Joe. And they had dreams and they asked, Joe could interpret dreams. And so he explained their dreams to them. And one of them, and he said, look, y'all, when you get back, and just remember me. And he said, oh, yeah, man, we'll remember you. And they didn't. Forgot all about it. Stayed in prison. Again, more hurt, more harm done on him. And sure enough, eventually, though, old Pharaoh himself has to have a dream interpreted. And it, God remembered, gone. That's this kid I met back in prison. Sir, I think he could help you out. And sure enough, they pulled Joe out of prison. He goes and he tells Pharaoh what his dream means. Pharaoh marvels at the wisdom that God's given Joseph, frees him from prison, changes his life completely, and God begins to use Joseph's gifts in leadership in Egypt. Well, guess what? Them brothers, way back, they've hard times have come on the land. The famine has forced them to have to come to Egypt for food. And they come, baskets, we need some food. And guess who they have to see? Guess who they have to see to get the food? Joseph. But they couldn't recognize him. Joe had grown up, Joe had matured, Joe wasn't wearing the common clothes they were used to seeing. And they didn't recognize him at all. But he knew who they were. And if that spirit of revenge, that spirit of retribution, that spirit of resentment was there, he had every opportunity to exercise it upon them. But his immediate concern was, how's my father? How's my little brothers? How are they doing? And of course, he didn't ask them initially. He went on, and first he needed to find out, had they changed? What's going on with them? And so he had a way of getting that accomplished by keeping one of the brothers and eventually getting his own full brother back and being able to see what happened. But let me cut to the chase, as Pastor Greene would say, cut across the field. Let's cut across the field. They end up in front of Joseph, begging for their lives. We don't know how that stuff got in. We didn't steal from you. We didn't. Oh, and Joe's looking at me. He knows. He knows. And finally, he can't hold it any longer. He breaks down, and he says, y'all, I'm your brother. I'm Joseph. I'm the one you hurt. I'm the one you threw away. And they went from being worried about losing some stuff to worried about dying. Like, oh no, we're in trouble now. But that was not the heart of Joseph. In chapter 50 of Genesis, in chapter 50 of Joseph, Joseph revealed himself and told him. He says, don't worry. Don't worry. God put me here to save you. God put me through what I've been through for a reason. God had a plan and a purpose in what I have been through. My injury was for the blessing of others. And I can understand that. It hurts. It hurt to be in prison. It hurt to be ridiculed. It hurt to be rejected.
Yeah, right.
But guess what? Joseph began to see God's plan. And in culmination of it, in chapter 50 and verse 15, it says, after, you know, eventually he brings the whole family into Egypt, provides for them, takes care of Jacob for the rest of his life. And sadly, after Jacob dies, and the brothers are begin to get concerned. Verse 15 of chapter 50, and when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said, Joseph peradventure will hate us and will certainly requite us all the evil which we did unto him. In other words, that resentment and desire for revenge, Job about to satisfy his long, long desire to get back. We're in trouble. He's a man. He's gonna get us. But that was not Joseph's mind at all. So they sent a messenger to Joseph saying, thy father did command before he died, saying, in other words, Joe, now won't you need to remember what daddy thought. So shall ye say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee now, the trespass of thy brethren and their sin. For they did unto thee evil, and now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of thy father. Boy, they were slick. They were like, we know how to, they must have went and talked to a lawyer. Just told them how to put this argument. Because we don't know for sure. The scripture doesn't record Jacob actually telling them this. Not saying it didn't happen, but this might have just been what they made up. Let's tell Joe, daddy said, you need to forgive us. But it didn't matter, because that was already Joseph's heart. That was already Joseph's mind. So they tell him that, and Joseph wept when they spake unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face. And they said, behold, we be thy servants. And here is the spirit of forgiveness. Joseph understood God's plan. He was able to have this release of what they owed him, because he understood there was purpose in it from God. God's in charge, and he has a plan. And the things that happen that are injurious to us sometimes are a part of what God's doing. And we need to be willing to yield and to submit to God's purpose. Notice what Joseph said, and Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of God? Meaning, God is the one that said, vengeance is mine. I will repay. And Joseph says, I'm not taking that role. But as for you, you thought evil against me. Boy, y'all had it in for me. I remember it. You thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive. You see, this is the Father who allowed his Son to go to the cross for our sins. The Son in the Garden of Gethsemane, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. The Lord is calling us to have that spirit, that mind that says, yes, I've been hurt. Yes, I've been grieved. Yes, I'm going through it. But nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Lord, if I have to hurt, if I have to suffer, Lord, if I have to go through the storm, then as one song says, Lord, bring the rain. Bring the rain. Because I know it's for your good, for your glory. Now, therefore, fear ye not. I will nourish you and your little ones. and he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. Y'all, that's the spirit of Christ. And we're called to that. That's number one. Remember, God is in charge and has a plan. Also, trust God to keep his word. Trust God to keep his word. In the book of Romans, chapter 12, we can count on God to do what he says he will do. Romans chapter 12, beginning at verse 19, reads, "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath." Meaning, lay that thing down. Put that down. Put it down. You ever had that? You ever had a little kid pick up something? You know, pick up something dangerous? And you put it down. And they like, put it down. That's what the Lord is saying. Beloved, thank you. Avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay. God will keep his promises. We have to know his plan, trust his plan, and know that he will do what he promises. If somebody's harmed you, they're going to give account to God. You don't have to worry about it. I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, because of that, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Lastly, third thing, remember God's love and mercy have forgiven you. In Matthew chapter 18, Jesus dealt with his disciples because they were wondering just how many times you have to forgive somebody. You know, because there's just this sense that, man, there's surely got to be a limit. How many times do I have to tell that boy, okay, when he says, I'm sorry? And Jesus answered their question with a parable. And the parable is a powerful one. It's the parable of the unforgiving servant. We won't take time to read it all, but it's in Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. And the basic gist of the parable is this. Jesus told them about a man who owed his master a great debt. Scripture says he owed his master 10,000 talents. You say, well, is that a lot? Sounds like a little bit. But let's put it in perspective. The talent was a weight. And the talent of silver, the weight that's described here, would be, in today's money, millions of dollars. Millions of dollars. So if somebody's into you for that much, I mean, he's the guy that says, you hadn't paid, I'm sending you to prison. He says, oh, please, have mercy, please, please. Okay, all right, you're free. Go home, take care of your family. You're free. Millions, just wrote it off. Woo! How drag, I'm free! And he goes down, and here comes one of his buddies. Yes, sir. And he sees his buddy, and you know what? His buddy owes him about 10 bucks. Buddy owes him about 10 bucks. Scripture says he grabs him by the throat.
Picked him up. Hold him by the throat.
caught him by the throat, jacked him up.
Boy, you better pay me my money. I'm going to take you to prison right now. Unfortunately for the servant, there was folks watching. And they went and told his master, they says, you won't believe what that boy did, that you forgave that those millions. And he brought him back. He brought him back before his Lord. And you know what the scripture says? It says, so when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and they came and they told unto their Lord all that was done. Then his Lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt because thou desiredst me to. You wanted it. You asked me for it. Shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due him. In other words, he was never going to pay it back. He was never getting out because he could never pay what was owed. You and I have to understand, when God tells us and asks us to be forgiven, he is telling us that that is something that we need to understand he has already done for us. We need to remember that we have been saved by grace because of God's mercy and love. We haven't earned it. We can't pay God back for the life of Jesus Christ. How foolish of us to think that there's some things we could do, some money we could give, some acts we could perform to somehow make up for the cost of the life of God's only begotten Son. But we owed our whole life to God for our sin. The wages of sin is death. And that's what we owe. God paid that debt for us through Christ Jesus. So when he asks us to forgive, he's not asking too much. And with the Spirit of God living in us, with Christ Jesus dwelling in us, we have the capacity to forgive. Even when we feel we are justified in seeking revenge or harboring resentment. You know, some folks won't ever take the kind of action of revenge. They won't go get their gun. They won't go set something on fire. But they will instead burn on the inside with resentment, with animosity, with hatred, with a sense of, I can't wait till something bad happens to them. I'm not going to do it, but boy, when something bad happens to them, I'm going to be glad. It's been proven psychologically that is killing you. That will kill you, and it will increase the level of stress in your life that will create problems in various systems of your health. It's not healthy physically, but it's even worse spiritually. Because it cuts you off from the Lord. It hampers your prayers. It distorts and ineffectuates your worship. The Lord says, you're going to come to me? You want to offer something to me? First, go and get right before you come here to be righteous. God wants us to do that. And when we do, and we can lay aside that weight, guess what? Guess what? That's when verse 2 of chapter of Hebrews 12, 2 comes in. Once you lay aside the weight, once you get forgiveness from the Lord and you give forgiveness to others, and of course there are any number of other weights that could be talked about other than this, but you lay aside all those weights, guess what? Look to Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. I'm telling you, you can look up. Instead of looking down at all the trash and all the garbage, look up and see who you are serving. And run, run, run free. I'm telling you, you know, when you...
65, it ain't much fun running anymore. But you know, about 45 years ago, running was a lot of fun. You know, even a little longer than that. In high school, I mean, being able to get out on the track, put on them little old skimpy shorts and little muscle t-shirt, them little light cleats, get on that track. I mean, I'm telling you, you warm up and you just came ready, just ready to go. And because why? Because you know what's coming ahead. You know you're going to try to win anyway. You might win, but you're going to try. You're going to give it all you got. And, oh, it was so much fun to run, to win. Oh, I ran individual races. I ran on relay teams. And what a joy to run. And Paul said, run to win when he writes to the Corinthians. Run to obtain. Run. Why? Because you're looking at a goal, the goal of satisfying the Savior who has given you life. Well, you know, sometimes you just don't get through, you just quit. So I'm going to quit. I thank the Lord for his goodness. I thank the Lord for his grace. I thank the Lord for his mercy. And I implore us, make sure that among the besetting weights that we face, we deal with the resentment and the desire for retribution that might be in our heart because of some wrong done to us. Don't keep carrying that. Yes. Put it down. Put it down. Lay it aside. Pastor Greene. Or come smile.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Pastor Smith shared that word with us. I stand to open up the invitation to Christ. There may be someone that's been struggling. I don't know about you, but I'm just glad to be here. Last Sunday I was in the hospital, didn't know if I was going to make it or not, but look at God. And I just want to give him thanks. I don't know about you, but he's been good to me. And it ain't been because I've been so good, brother, but it was because of his grace and his mercy. And he have allowed us to come today to worship him. God is so good to us. With every head bowed, every eye closed. If Jesus came through that door right now, and you know that you hadn't accepted Christ as your Savior, now is that opportunity that you can ask God to come into your heart and forgive you for your sins. Then that gives you the right to praise him, gives you the right to love him, gives you the right to have a relationship with him. So I encourage you today, as someone under the sound of my voice that don't know Jesus, I recommend him to you today. Maybe someone that's sick. Doctors say you may not get well, but I know for a fact that God is a healer because he healed me. And I just want to say thank you, Lord. You may be looking for a church home. You're not under the safety of God. You need him to protect you. There was someone that went to sleep on last night that prepared to come to church, but yet they didn't make it. God has given us another chance. Another chance to get it right, because we can't get it right. Because the Bible said we're looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher. Yes, we're in a race. And there's a crowd of people watching you. So I pray today that God would just keep us in the palm of his hand. That if we fall, we don't fall out of his hand, but into his hand. Will there be one today and say, I'll step out on faith today and give God my heart? Someone today may say, well, I need a good church home. I recommend Pilgrim Valley. Will there be one today? Will there be one that can just step out on Jesus? Amen. You know, this second is not promised. It was just last Sunday I was laying in the hospital. Didn't know if I was going to get well. But God touched my body and I can tell him, thank you.
Yes.
We see that there's none, but there's still room.
Amen.
Let us pray. Eternal Father, creator and maker of all things. Lord, we thank you for this day. You are the author and the finisher. Lord, we're just pilgrims going through this city. Lord, we ask that you would save us, that you would deliver us, that you would set the captives free. Lord, bless our pastor, bless his wife, bless this congregation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, all right, all right, all right, right, all right. Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Well, all right, all right, all right. Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Hey, man, let's give God a hand praise. Let's give God a hand. Y'all stay in the same spirit because it's giving time. Amen. Can I ask you a question? Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me, God said. But you say, wherein have we robbed thee? He said, in tithes and offerings. I mean, there's been a lot of controversy about Malachi here lately. I've been hearing on social media and around these different areas that Old Testament don't count no more, but I think it's in the Bible. I think God said it, didn't he? I think God said he don't change, didn't he? He said his word don't change, didn't he? So I still believe God's word. I still believe what God said here in Malachi. So you, it's up to you whether you believe a new gospel or not, you want to. But God says, you have robbed me. And I know we don't want to rob God, do we? So it's our opportunity right now to show God how much we love him. My son asked me about Malachi. I said, how can we rob God? How can you rob God? That's a good question, I said. I said, you rob God. God loves us so much that in all through his scriptures, all he wants to do is bless us. That's what his word of God leads to. A lot of the scriptures lead to blessing, how you can be blessed by God. He shows us how to bless. He tells us how to be blessed. That's his main desire. Above all things, he said, I want to bless you and make you happy. Above all things. So when you don't give your tithes and offering, that's your opportunity, that's your portal for blessings. God opens that portal up for blessings. So if we don't do that, then we rob God of his satisfaction of blessing us. He gets satisfaction out of blessing. He wants to see us happy. But it's up to us to do as he said. Amen? I don't have to break it down, do it. Amen. It's in the word of God. So this is our opportunity right now to make God happy. And when God happy, his pocketbook opens up. He got big pockets. Deep pockets, amen? So we prepare our hearts right now to give. Return back to the Lord. Hi. how he has blessed us. Get our hearts prepared to be obedient to God. As the officers and the ushers come down, receive this offering. I call it seesawing time. Yeah. Seesawing time. Whatsoever a man sows. Whatsoever a man sows. That.
Come on and bless the Lord with me. 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 Bless the Lord.
That you would bless it, Father, you would use it for the building of thy kingdom. We ask that you would bless those that gave, those that had a desire to give. It is in the name of Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen. Amen.
Church said amen. 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 What a wonderful, wonderful celebration of the Lord today. Great word. Amen. Powerful, 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 powerful word. Amen. Amen. Reverend Bronnie would say, if you didn't get that, then your wood just wet or something to that extent. That didn't light your fire, your wood just wet. Amen? Amen. Thank God again for this day. Thank God for our youth there. Our youth were in the back on today for Youth Sunday. So we're grateful for all those teachers and instructors who were in the back. But then we know they had their own service back there in the back. Right after morning service, our ushers are going to have a training in the sanctuary. So what I want to do, we're going to be ready to have our announcements in a minute, but what I want to do real quick right after morning service, I want us to get pictures of everybody who's representing your team, whatever your team is, and we want to just get a big picture, amen. One picture. This time I'll make sure somebody use my phone and my camera, because I still ain't got pictures for them. I got one or two, but I'm going to make sure my phone get in there somewhere. So somebody who's not wearing a jersey, you're not going to get in the pictures, and you can take a picture. Two qualifications now. Don't be in a jersey, but you know how to take a picture. Don't be taking no selfies and give me my phone back to me. Amen? All right. Let's do this. I want all of our January birthdays, if y'all would come down front. Amen. Come to the front. All of our January birthdays. Amen. I'm going to come on down myself. My birthday's today. All of our January birthdays, we're going to celebrate real quick right now. This is the beginning of a brand new year, and we're going to be singing, and we're going to represent every month. At the end of the month, we're going to have a special singing for every person for the month. Amen. Paul, hit it. Give me something now. Give me some of that volume. Go and crank it up. Amen. Now, y'all ain't been saved all your life. Y'all might well stand on up. Act like you know this song. Act like you're excited for us for this month. Because at the end of next month, we're going to do this for you as well, whoever birthday is it. So when that part comes where everybody can sing, you can fake it for right now. But when that happy birthday part comes, I want to hear you sing. Amen? Sing it. That's what I'm talking about. Amen. Amen. You're not, the Lord not going to get you if you sing this song. I promise you.
How much we love you, and I'm sure you would agree. What could be more perfectly?
You can hear your part right here. Come on.
On the day you came to be. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Amen. That's good. That's good. Come on. Come on. Thank you. January birthdays. Amen. Right. Yeah. Amen. What's that?
We didn't do that in October.
Amen. Now, see, Everybody ain't saved like they say they is. I just got through saying, we starting this in January. And you gonna get yours in October. When yours come around in October. But for right now, we starting the year off right. Amen. Is that all right? Let's give God a hand praise. Amen. Don't forget, Wednesday night Bible study at 6 o'clock p.m. We're still dealing with this year Jubilee. We had a great Bible study on this past Wednesday night. There's a place for you. Amen. If you come on out on Wednesday nights, we're just celebrating what God is doing. Do we have any other announcements for this week? Any other announcements real quick? Amen. We'll be in the fellowship hall on Wednesday night. So when you come, make sure you go to the side doors over here. All right, Sister Pam.
The youth will be practicing this Tuesday at 6 o'clock in preparation for Black History Month program. So even if they don't sing, please bring your kids out because we have something for them to do. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. All right. All minds clear? Thank God again. All right. We'll have Reverend Smith come back and give us our final remarks, closing prayer, and our benediction.
Do we have any visitors this morning? Well, if you are a visitor and you don't choose to be recognized, we still are glad you're here.
That's right.
And we thank the Lord for your presence and ask for his blessings on your life. Now our benediction. Please stand. And don't forget, following the benediction, if you want to be a part of the photograph, come down front. The benediction comes from the book of Hebrews, 13th chapter, verses 20 and 21. Listen to the Lord's words. Now the God of peace, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And let us all say, Amen.